So it's just worth being our third keynote for the day. Professor in Victoria Literature and Culture from St Anne's College, who has been a pioneer really in the field of literature and science and medicine. The previous books on George Eliot and 19th century science, Charlotte Bronte and Victorian psychology, and most recently The Mind of the Child, which is on child development in literature, science and medicine. In recent years, Sally has been the principal investigator of two large projects, the Diseases of Modern Life project, which you've heard about earlier today, funded by the ERC, and also Constructing Scientific Communities, which looks at citizen science in the 19th and 21st centuries, funded by the AHRC. So we're very grateful to Sally for speaking earlier and coming back to offer the final plenary of the day.
Thank you, Melissa. When we think about the connections between literary texts and medical case studies, perhaps the immediate association, I should say before you attended this conference today, might have been that of Freud. Psychoanalysis, of course, is virtually founded on the reinterpretation of Sophocles as Oedipus. Freud also drew extensively on more contemporary literature. His essay on the uncanny, for example, was focused very much on E.T.A. Hoffman's disturbing story, The Sandman. And it's often thought that Freud was odd or unusual in his literary proclivities, and indeed, for this very reason, not very scientific. Yet, if we turn to psychiatry as it was developing in the 19th century pre-Freud, we find that literature plays a key role. Shakespeare inevitably looms large, so the asylum keeper and founder of the Journal of Mental Science, J.C. Bucknell, wrote in 1859 The Psychology of Shakespeare. Then he followed that up with The Mad Folk of Shakespeare. John Connolly, who was responsible for the basically non-restraint, the development of non-restraint in the asylums and moral management, he did a study of Hamlet. Henry Maudsley, indeed, also did an essay on Hamlet. At the time, it could be very much safely assumed by these writers that the middle-class audiences that they're writing for would know their Shakespeare. All the plays, but particularly Hamlet, offered a form of case study that was held in common by both the medic and the audience. So when they were writing, it wasn't simply an individual experience between the psychiatrist and the patient that had to be summarised for the readers. Almost there was a tripartite relationship between the play, the audience, the readers, and the psychiatrist and writer, giving so a sense almost of a higher validity if you were using a literary text than if you were simply reproducing your own notes from a literary case study. Such texts also play a significant role in helping to transform cultural perceptions of mental disorders in the 19th century. I'm sure you're familiar with all those representations of madness before the 19th century, with Bedlam and all the maniacs chained up, and the sense that they were separated entirely from the sane. During the 19th century, the idea emerged that the mad were indeed very little different from ourselves. There's lots of descriptions in the newspapers, popular writing, of how there's a thin dividing line between the sane and the insane. And people often talk about the fact that the only real difference between the sane and the insane is whether you actually articulate what's going on underneath or you keep it sort of firmly down below. So a sense then that everybody was potentially at risk. And so this was a rewriting of what it meant to be insane and how they understood mental disorders. And I think the cultural prestige of Shakespeare was actually drawn upon to bring about a shift in social attitudes to mental disorders. So literature then being quite fundamental in the whole transformation of understanding. But interestingly, I think almost more interesting than the use of Shakespeare was that literary works, and particularly more recent works, opened up new territory for the emerging science of psychiatry, often furnishing the grounding for new theoretical frameworks. in my book, as it mentioned, The Mind of the Child, which looked at ideas of child development in the literature, science and medicine of the Victorian age, I showed how this was particularly the case with reference to childhood. So I have to give a caricature here, really, but prior to this time, although there had been the cult of childhood innocence, for example, in the Romantic period, very little attention had been paid to the inner life of the child, the storms and the inner turmoil of emotional and intellectual growth. Educationalists attended to see children simply as empty vessels to be filled, while early psychiatrists had assumed that mental disorders and insanity were afflictions that only came with adult life. But in the mid-Victorian period, in mid-century, you get the rise of the great novels focused on child development. So, for example, Dickens, Dombey and Son, David Copperfield, Great Expectations, Charlotte Bronte, Jane Eyre, or George Eliot's The Mill on the Floss, all of them looking quite intensely at the development of childhood and the experiences of that child. So a sense then that all the understanding of what it was to be a child changed utterly, I think, in the mid-century. Children were revealed as possessing intense inner lives, with emotional suffering in childhood that was liable to shape their entire adult lives. Psychology and psychiatry were offered new territory thus to explore, and it's possible, I think, to trace the direct impact from the literary to the medical text. So I offer a few examples here. So first of all, Dickens' novel of 1848, Dombey and Son, which if you know the novel, it's in part about the way in which Dombey the merchant imposes himself and his desires upon his poor son, who pressed out of life virtually. And he's known as an old-fashioned child. This is poor little Paul with Mrs. Pipchin, who he's put in charge of at one point before he goes to Dr. Blimber's establishment. This is a picture of Dr. Blimber with his young gentlemen enjoying themselves, a sense of the utter depression and control. Dickens writes about the form of education that these poor young gentlemen get. He says, Dr. Blimber's establishment was a great hothouse in which there was the forcing apparatus incessantly at work. All the boys blew before their time. Mental green peas were produced at Christmas, and intellectual asparagus all year round. Nature was of no consequence at all. So a strong sense then that what was happening was an agricultural forcing system operating within the form of education. Now, these sorts of thoughts had been around, but hadn't been addressed really in the medical literature. After Dickens, Dr. Blimber's establishment becomes the standard case history of forcing. One wonderful psychiatrist takes this up. I love the 1859 article on the artificial production of stupidity in schools, which I think is one of the best titles of the educational text that perhaps ever I love in the sort of medical literature, that it says with such concision the utter contempt that they held for what was happening within educational system at that time. And he also wrote that slightly more measured on the influence of educational training in preventing diseases of the nervous system, but very much arguing that education was responsible for creating them. Interestingly, what you find in the 19th century, that this builds up into, sort of over the decades, you see it becoming more and more of a social issue, until in the 1880s there are huge petitions, there's the questions in Parliament, all sorts of reports are produced, and you get a liaison between the medical establishment and the teachers, all arguing against the form of education which I would argue is returning to us now. Payment by results, everybody being pressured to go through competitive examining. In Carter, you get wonderful descriptions of brain forcing. So the young, being under the age of 10, being working at their books until midnight, crippled alike in mind and body by the effect of excessive and premature study. By the time the 1880s, they start to talk about the fact that even though that the young is starting to commit suicide because of all these pressures. And I'd like to suggest that there are very strong parallels with all that and now. So these are headlines from fairly a few years ago, but if you remember that there was an epidemic of suicides that people were concerned about in the young, and a lot of trying to link problems in mental health of the young with what was happening in the schools, and the suggestion that the British system, with its obsession with examining, was actually creating the most unhappy children in the world. My second example of the way in which literature influenced psychiatry is that of Leonard Guthrie, who wrote one of the first books, full book-length study of child psychiatry. This is The Functional Nervous Disorders in Childhood, which was published in 1907. In this, he talks about the fact that all the ailments and the psychological problems of children had been ignored until the late 19th century. He says, advice was not asked for peevish, passionate children, nor for those who were afraid of the dark and unnaturally timid, absent-minded or brooding and morose, jealous, spiteful or cruel, nor for mischievous, untruthful, dishonest or immoral children. All such defects were regarded as moral rather than morbid, and were treated as such. Basically, children were punished. And in talking about how one should develop this new child psychiatry, he says the best thing to do is to turn to George Eliot's Mill on the Floss. And he quotes in particular a passage from Mill on the Floss, which actually occurs, if you know the novel, when the young Maggie, in a fit of anger and frustration, cuts off her own hair and then really lives to regret it. She says, and he quotes, "We can no longer recall the poignancy of that moment and weep over it as we do over the remembered sufferings of 5 or 10 years ago. Every one of those keen moments has left its trace and lives in us still. But such traces have blent themselves irrecoverably with the firmer texture of our youth and manhood. And so it comes to pass that we can look on at the troubles of our children with a smiling disbelief in the reality of their pain." So what he's pinpointing there is this transition from the period in which childhood, he was silly, he was not really feeling it, and the fact that as you grow older, you forget yourself quite what the intensity of that suffering was. And he's saying that no, what we need to do is absolutely foreground the notion that what happens in childhood is crucial for later developments. So obviously Freud and others will talk about this later. But it's coming through, I think, from an understanding of what was happening in the 19th century novel and the literary opening up of childhood so that you could accept that children suffered just as adults do, and potentially even more so. I'd also say that not only does Guthrie start with Mill on the Floss, but he takes his theoretical framework for the entire work from the Mill on the Floss. He talks initially, interestingly, given the experience today, but what I understood was that psychiatrists don't normally talk about their own sufferings. And mostly in science, you do not see yourself as a subject. But Guthrie actually opens up to what he says are his own neuroses, which he traces back to his sufferings in childhood. And he then talks about the fact that he has developed a system where he divides people almost into two: the neurotic temperament with which he identifies and which he links to Maggie Tulliver, the passionate and intellectual, wonderfully spirited heroine of Mill on the Floss, and the unemotional temperament, which is that of her brother Tom, whose sturdy, orthodoxy, conservative, repressive presence. And so the whole theoretical framework of this text, I think, is actually taken from Mill on the Floss. The main example I want to offer you today is, I'm afraid, from a book that you might vaguely have heard of, but will probably, I assume, absolutely not have read. And that is a book by George Borrow called Lavengro of 1851. I'm assuming no one's read it. I certainly hadn't until I came across it. I came across it when I was researching the history of phobias in the 19th century. You're probably familiar with the fact that it was in 1871 that Carl Vespal published a paper on agoraphobia. He identified three different patients who all were all sort of rational middle-class people in control of themselves in all other aspects of their lives, but couldn't cross open squares in Berlin. From this point on, you get a huge growth of research in phobia across Germany and France, with diagnoses of all sorts of phobias. But interestingly, it looks like the UK was very slow to follow. So Westphal, it was reported marginally when he first wrote, but very little followed through into the British press until 1896. And the first outing, as it were, really, of phobias was in a paper, I'll come back to that in a minute. That's the George Borrow, but I will move on for now. So, W. Julius Mickle, he was delivering the presidential address at the 55th annual meeting of the Medico-Psychological Association. And this was then published in the Journal of Mental Science, which is now the British Journal of Psychiatry. And he called his work Mental Besetments. Fundamentally, it is an analysis of the development of phobias. But just to go back, so I don't miss out the slide, so the George Borrow, Lavengro, subtitled The Scholar, the Gypsy, the Priest. And if you've heard of it at all, it's all about, people think of it as, oh, he's the man that went off and joined the gypsies, and it's all about having fun on the road and going back to nature and that sort of thing. But if you look at the book, which I imagine not many people have really done, apart from the members of the George Borrow Society, of which there is one, it described very early on as the history, up to a certain period, of one of rather a peculiar mind and system of nerves. That is precisely what Mickle picks up on. So in this talk, he says that he's going to talk about mental besetments or obsessions, the state in which the mind is affected by some compulsive thought or irrational and often progressive fear, alone or conjoined with an impulse which is or tends to become irresistible. And he argues that these sorts of fears can become, in their full-blown form, mental perturbation to the self that results in the mental subjugation and slavery of the affected person. And he characterises them according to, well, it seems to me a very modern way of talking, but the three Ds: besetting doubts, dread, and what he calls the besetting impulse to deeds. So that's the obsessive compulsion to touch or some sort of other compulsive form. And he sees these forms of obsession as having close relationships to neurasthenia, paranoia, hypochondria, and hysteria, but also as being quite clinically distinct. Outlining the three fundamental forms, he includes under doubts, involuntary questionings, uncontrollable questionings, as well as morbid impulses of touching, and under dreads, various forms of phobia up to nameless horror, whilst deeds concerns the irresistible impulse so often associated with these obsessions. In evidence, he offers seven detailed case histories from his own practice before ending up with Lavengro, which he says he read in fascination in boyhood, and offers the best description and the earliest full one of some of the forms of obsession. And I have to just stop, I think, to think about the oddness of this. even for the 19th century, because here he is giving the annual address to the assembled company. And what he's doing is devoting, well, he does give his own case histories, but he then devotes 16 pages in the printed text of discussion of the novel. So it's not a minor passing reference. It's really quite fundamental to his analysis. So Borrow himself described his novel as the history, up to a certain period, of one of a rather peculiar mind and system of nerves. But it's rarely been read like that by literary critics. But if one looks at the structure of the novel, it's absolutely tracing through from childhood onwards the problems that this child has. The child is described as a lover of nooks and retired corners, who had a habit of fleeing from society. He was conscious from early childhood of a peculiar heaviness within me, and at times of a strange sensation of fear, which occasionally amounted to horror, and for which I could assign no real cause whatsoever. And this sense of a causeless fear sets up a thematic strand which runs through the novel, both in terms of Lavengro's own life and also in the episodic accounts of those he meets, who all manifest particular forms of obsession. So really, although it's structured around the narrator's life, he constantly meets people on his travels who all manifest similar forms of psychological problems. The reception of the novel has been quite mired in whether this is truthful or not, and whether it's an autobiography, etc. And people, but Nicol himself is absolutely certain that it's based upon Borrow's life, and I would agree. How else, he asks, could at the time Borrow have obtained so conspicuously accurate and clear a knowledge of the condition? The novel is one of the exceedingly few examples of mental abnormality accurately portrayed in works of fiction. It is a cry from the deep waters of affliction, a marvel of self-representation fashioned in the fire of suffering. I think Nicol's rather romanticised vision, perhaps, of authorship here nonetheless raises an intriguing question with regard to the relationship between literature and medical practice. So how far did Nicol's own boyhood reading of the work feed into his own subsequent theoretical interest in fears and obsessions, and his formulation of a psychological model which unusually placed an obsession to touch and associated forms of fear at the very heart of a model of obsession? So in other words, did the early literary reading help frame the subsequent medical model? So in Mickle's reading, Lavengro illustrates all aspects of his own theories of fear and obsession. And I should say also that there are grounds, if one looks at the history of Mickle himself, he's clearly related to an 18th century poet who was also called W. Mickle. And he talks about the fact that he nearly met Borrow in adolescence, which would have been very helpful because there was an issue they needed to discuss. So, to my mind, not very concrete evidence, but I'm pretty sure that Mickle himself perceived himself as a sufferer. So the development of Lavengro is almost the reverse of a straightforward linear narrative of a life, because in keeping with the dark nooks and crannies of the narrator's mind, it moves fitfully sort of across and between the individuals and other people's stories. And at the point in adolescence, when future professions are being discussed for the narrator, who remains nameless, he moves into a rapid decline, emerges into a form of convalescence, into a dark feeling of mysterious dread which comes over the mind, in which the lamp of reason, though burning bright the while, is unable to dispel. And this passage is then followed by an inserted dialogue between a generic boy and his mother, which follows, I think, almost the form of a medical consultation, attempting to understand the ground of his fear. And this is all just represented by Nicol. So, what ails you, my child, said a mother to her son as he lay on a couch under the influence of the dreadful one. What ails you? What you seem afraid, boy? So I am. A dreadful fear is upon me. Mother, but of what? There is no one that can calm you. Of what are you apprehensive? Boy, of nothing that I can express. I know not what I am afraid of, but afraid I am. Mother, perhaps you see sights and visions. Boy, mine is a dread of I know not what, and there the horror lies. Mother, your forehead is cool and your speech collected. Do you know where you are? Boy, I know where I am, and I see things just as they are, that there's no ground for being afraid. I am, moreover, quite cool and feel no pain. And in fact, in the original novel, it goes on for quite a long time. In virtue as a form, I think, of medical consultation here. Which I think is very interesting that Borrow is virtually suggesting that what you've got here is a medical episode. Now the narrator continues to have his nameless sort of fear and dread, and he moves into, first of all he goes down to London as a lowly paid figure in a publishing house, where again he says he's assailed by my own peculiar ideas with respect to everything being a lying dream. And that sort of frame sense that he's actually living in a lying dream continues throughout the novel. He then goes off again on the road, and he meets at one point in a pub or tavern a stranger who he sees keeps making some odd touching gestures, and he says to him, "Aha, I know what you're doing." And the stranger is so startled that he invites him back, and then what you get is a full-fledged history of the stranger, who turned out to be an author. And he talks about how he was a child who was born with what he terms excessive sensibility, and whenever he had feelings of pleasure, they were followed by distress and gloom. And he talks about how, when he was very young, he was given a couple of hawks by his uncle, and he was delighted but terrified because he didn't know where they come from and whether he really, really possessed them. And so endless questions were, who did you get them from, who did they get them? And so it continues. And the same obsessive doubtings and questionings happen later on when he's given a pony. There's a wonderful sense of this child being tortured by that which he also loves as well. And then there comes a point when his mother falls ill. And he starts to think that actually, if he does strange things, he could actually help her. This is a description that he offers of how he finds himself touching things, you know, whatever it was, now table or chair, now such. And he tries to struggle against this feeling that he has to go around touching, but in vain. I've even rushed away from the object, but I was sure to return. The impulse was too strong to be resisted. I quickly hurried back, compelled by the feeling within me to touch the object. But then, somehow, he feels that if he climbs a tree, then somehow his mother will recover from her illness. Ah, so this is a picture of the stranger touching the gate in a slightly later version. Then this is his description of attempting to climb the tree at night. He said, "Indeed, all the time that I was performing these strange feats, I knew them to be highly absurd, yet the impulse to perform them was irresistible, a mysterious dread hanging over me till I had given way to it. Even at that early period, I frequently used to reason within myself as to what could be the cause of my propensity to touch. But of course, I could come to no satisfactory conclusion respecting it. Being heartily ashamed of the practice, I never spoke of it to anyone, and was at all times highly solicitous that no one should observe my weakness." So there's both this sense of his understanding how odd this habit was and how unreasonable, but also, even at an early age, trying to hide it from others. Now, our narrator, when he hears all this himself, becomes obsessed himself with desires to touch. He flees himself. This is a wonderful picture, I think, of him at Stonehenge, absolutely in despair. And then this is a yes. So this is the despair. He suffers at this point. With every moment, I felt it gathering force and making more wholly its own. What should I do? Resist, of course, and I did resist. I grasped, I tore, and I strove to fling it from me. But of what avail were my efforts? I could only have got rid of it by getting rid of myself. It was a part of myself, or rather, it was all myself. I rushed amongst the trees and struck at them with my bare fists and dashed my head against them, but I felt no pain. How could I feel pain with a horror upon me? A quite wonderful description, I think, of the levels of suffering he undergoes. The illustration this time, I'm afraid, just doesn't cut it. A man in agony, you can't really depict it. But what I feel that the text really does is manage to show the real sufferings of our protagonist. So in the end, what we find, sorry, I just lost my last piece of paper. Sorry, I'll finish with that. So to suggest that what we've got with the Mickle here and the Borrow is a psychiatrist turning to a literary text. He's given us the seven case histories, but what as readers, and I imagine the initial audience of this talk went away with, was not the careful clinical descriptions, which in turn, once you've read the text of Borrow, you realise had actually formed the theoretical framework, but it's also that when you come away from that text or that audience, what you're doing is being haunted by the borrow, the wild, unexplained emotion that just refuses to fit into any category and just overwhelms the reader, I think, with that sense of suffering. Now, end of my